electronics manufacturing and education segments with a position for new technologies and focus on productivity. He tries to address complex problems from a different angle and provides simple solutions. He was an active member of the team that created MRP2 in BHEL Bangalore and successfully created India's best computer-based exam system of Edequity for high-stakes exam that is used for various exams of public service commissions as well as education institutions since 2004. He has received 19 productivity awards in BHEL, always looking to leverage new technologies that are appropriate for the end user. And he believes in thinking simple and nothing is impossible. Let's hear from our expert on new pathways to building a better future. Over to you, sir.
Thanks for good words. Feel happy. Good to meet so many young people on the platform. And without wasting time, I think I'll move on to the presentation first. Then we can have a question answer session. Whenever people want to ask anything, probably they can interrupt in between also. So let me share the screen. Can you see the screen? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, the screen is visible.
Okay. Now the topic is building a better future. How do you actually plan your future? I think all of them are engineering students, so I'll be focusing only on engineering students right now. You are already on an education highway. You already paid the toll. And then you have entered into the engineering college and you are in a high speed lane and you are in a beautiful road, which is beautiful to drive. You know how to enjoy your life. You are in the best part of your life. So just take the best advantage of the entire system in your, which is available for you. As you go towards the final year, your roads will split into three or four, depending on what you are looking at. One is going abroad, higher studies, entrepreneurship, and jobs. And once you take this, any one of these roads, coming back into the second one will take some time. So you have to be very, very clear in your mind which road, which path you want to take. Are you sure about whatever is the path you want to take? You should think over before you enter the lane. So up to the toll, it's fine. When the road is deviating, you should be very careful which path you should take. Third year is the ideal time when you have to take your decision. Second year also helps, but fourth year is a bit late. So whoever is in the third year, you should start planning for your future. First one is study abroad. Everybody knows they can go abroad to do some good MS or whatever it is. Then you identify the country, university, courses, and then you start preparing your GMAT, GRE, TOEFLs, whatever it is, how do you write the SOPs and how to get the recommendation letters. Identifying the university itself will take a lot of time, which university will give you the scholarships. All those things take a lot of time. So you do thorough research before you decide to go abroad. If you want, you take the help of experts, otherwise you will be losing out a lot of things. Second is higher education in India itself. If you don't want to go abroad, there are plenty of opportunities in India. You can do your post-graduation, your own core engineering, or you can probably work for 1 or 2 years and then do MBA. Or if you want to give a shot in the first year itself, you can try your MBA. Then some people may like to do some sort of research or fellowships and all that. Some people may also try to just take a break after the engineering and then pursue their hobbies. If somebody is interested in doing some sort of adventure tourism, they can try that. Whatever they want, it's all left to you what you want to do in your life. So once you select this particular line, pursue in the same line as long as possible. Third is entrepreneurship. Today, everybody is talking about entrepreneurship. How do you start my own? What is there in for me? How do I grow? How do I sell the company and make money? The best thing is you have to first find out which is the, pardon? Anybody is asking? Okay. First, you have to look at somebody's pain point or your own pain point. Somebody is facing some issues. It is an opportunity for you. Somebody's talking? Somebody's asking some question? Okay. It should not be a college project. Most of the people, they think a college project can be extended as an entrepreneur project. But I am afraid it will not work that way. College projects are different. Entrepreneur projects are totally different. Entrepreneur projects are solving somebody's major issue. So first, you may have a great idea, but you should always have a partner in when you are starting a company or any entrepreneur venture. You should have at least two partners so that you can think more, you can discuss more, you can approach more, you can share your workload. Those things are very important. Then your professors are there always to help you, and there is a generally an entrepreneur development cell in your colleges. Take best advantage of it. Then find out who actually is going to use your product or solution. How do you do the market validation, whether the market really needs it or not, who are the competition, how those things work. Those things are major issues in any entrepreneur journey. Now you have to bootstrap your funds. You have to beg, borrow from your family, brother, relatives, whoever it is, whoever trusts you. You will talk to them, convince them, and then try your thing. But don't expect that somebody will give you a huge money as a funding the moment they hear about your idea. Best thing is to make a minimum viable product to show to people and get some feedback from the people. Without MVP, it's very difficult for you to actually convince anyone to actually buy your concept or an idea. And self-employed also comes under actually a sort of entrepreneurship. That's why I put under this. Self-employed can be anything. They can be a content writer. They can be a freelancer. No, anything can be under that. So you basically have a passion and you want to leverage that passion to make some money also. Then fourth one is the job. When you decide to go for a job, you should be very clear in your mind what kind of company you want to work for, first of all. Whether it's a multinational company or it's a startup or it's a manufacturing or a edutech, healthcare. Or you should never say anything is okay. Or you can't say undecided, whichever comes to me, let me take it. It won't work that way. Maybe you'll get in, but soon you'll get actually disappointed and you'll start getting frustrated. So first you think over, if you are given an opportunity, which kind of company you would like to work. So you put a tick mark, maybe it can be more than one. You can say multinational company and edtech or a startup or which is into research. So it can be more than one. But this is only as a checklist for you to identify what exactly you want to do in future. Generally, there are a lot of mistakes what students do. You think I am in a best college, I am branded college, I will get a job, why I should worry about anything else. Many people think I am very good in my subject, I will easily get a job. And some people think, okay, yeah, let us complete this course, then we'll see anything. Anyway, family business is there, I can work on that. These are all, I put them under overconfidence. Never be overconfident till you reach the goal. At the same time, there are many more people who are very low on confidence. They'll think nobody comes to the campus for placement and I am not getting good marks. I can't even speak. Really, am I good? Who will give me a job? Where are the jobs? All these kind of doubts are there in your mind. So let us start working on these things for a time being, forgetting about all this confidence and all that. So you start planning, prepare and perform. If you are in a third year, you have ideal time for you to plan. Second year is still better. You can go slow and you can learn more and more. Basically, your strengths we split into knowledge and skill. Knowledge is what you learn in your classrooms, whatever your professors are teaching, you learn in the libraries and all that, which is the syllabus based. Second one is learn with the interest. You know what you like something about artificial intelligence and how it works, or somebody says Bitcoin. What is Bitcoin? And you go into the cryptocurrency and learn. Some people may get interested in cybercrime. And so you go and learn those kind of a thing. That's all the knowledge. The second one is skill. That is where you are actually putting your knowledge into work. And then you already doing a lot of good work and you are getting good marks in your subjects. But there is some area which you should actually learn and do something. Skill is what you have to have practice. Knowledge can be is only it is there in your mind. Unless you do something, your skill will not get improved. And skills also, I split up into three different types. One is the technical skills, soft skills, and social media skills. Technical skills is what actually you undergo in your college. Professor are teaching you something, you are doing some practicals. Whatever you are doing in your college, I put them under technical skills. Second is the social media skills, which are very, very important nowadays. You know what are all the, so that we'll cover now. And majority of the requirement is your soft skills. 90%, 75% is your soft skills. Technical skills is basically all the fundamentals, whatever you are learning in your college. Try to do that, learn more, do some experiments. And you keep learning something new also. Suppose you are working in a core engineering like civil. Even in civil, you can probably start implementing some AI and artificial intelligence and machine learning based systems in the civil engineering or mechanical engineering. If you are doing a routine work, artificial intelligence will definitely help you in avoiding all those things. Then you talk about soft skills. Soft skills have got three different areas. One is a communication skill, one is analytical skills, and problem solving skills. Speaking skills include communication. You read as much as possible, talk to your friends. If you are comfortable in any language, it's fine. You have to be very conversant in your own language, expressing yourself. You should be able to express yourself very well given a time-bound situation. And of course, if you know English, it is the best. You'll have a lot of advantage. And I suggest people to actually take your own, instead of taking a selfie, you start your camera. Just record on 30 seconds or whatever it is. You just say, what is the weather in Bangalore today? Why is COVID-19 is spoiling so many people's lives? It could be any topic. You take any topic of a newspaper topic or your own. You can just say, my best friend is so-and-so. I don't like this particular subject. It can be anything. But for 30 seconds, non-stop, can you record your own video and then watch it 2-3 times? Then you will know how many times you are pausing, how many times you are saying, this kind of a thing, whether you can talk continuously, confidently. Once you are very confident in that, you are ready for facing any world. Social media skills are very, very important today because that is where you meet a lot of strangers, you know how to behave with others. Facebook tells you so many things, LinkedIn. I don't know how many of you are on LinkedIn. I recommend all of you to actually join the LinkedIn to learn from the industry experts. You may not be actually posting anything. You are not actively contributing anything, but you learn a lot by actually reading posts of others, different topics, how they think, what could be the opportunities like in industry. And in between, you can always ask a question to anyone on LinkedIn saying that, sir, I want to know more about this. What is your company all about? Then you build a relationship with those people. Twitter, I recommend people to try on Twitter more than anything else because you should be able to express yourself in a few words, maybe about a sentence or two. Can you put the entire thing in 200 characters or 140 characters to 240 characters, whatever it is? That actually helps you a lot in actually telling in very brief what you want to tell. Every social media app has a purpose and you'll have some sort of business plan in that. You should be able to analyze how it helps you in any other way. Project works, everybody does project works in engineering college, but unfortunately most of them take previous year's project and then just modify it to some extent and again put it back in a beautiful cover and submit back. This is very, very wrong approach. You have to make some project which is very, very relevant to your liking, what you want to do in future, and you should be able to actually do that yourself. Unless you don't do yourself, you will not learn anything. By taking somebody's code and say, going through that and say, okay, this is what they have done, I understood what they have done. No, it won't work that way. In any interview, I ask, only the first question is, what is the biggest problem you faced in the project? In that particular thing, if somebody says, I didn't have any problem. It means he has never done anything in the project. And if he says, okay, I had this problem and I solved it. Now I know what is that big problem, what he thinks is actually a big problem or is a very small problem. So I know the way, how much he is thinking. Now, second one we ask is, how did you solve the problem? So we will like to know how you have approached the problem and how did you solve the problem. So if you do any project, you keep it in mind, what are all the problems you are facing? How are you solving them? Even if you are not solved, still better for me, because at least I know that you have tried at least three different ways to actually solve the problem. So that is more important to me than projecting a small issue as a big problem and saying that I solved it without any problem. So that won't actually excite me to take you. If you say I have a big problem, which is a really a critical problem, and if you say I am not able to solve because I didn't have experience or I need some inputs, then I would love to actually take you and say, okay, you are probing for the very, very dangerous thing and you are trying to solve and find an issue. Find the solution, sir. And also when you are deciding to work or take up a job, many people actually, though they do civil, mechanical, electrical, chemical, whatever it is, they land up in doing IT jobs. It could be good for them or bad for them, that we are not here to judge. You should decide if you do a core mechanical engineering or a civil engineering, whether you want to take up job in the same core engineering or you want to try something else. There is nothing wrong going into IT because salaries are good. Everybody agrees to that, no issues about that. But as a civil engineer, you can always learn something on AI ML and then use it in your own thing, or you can always learn a project management and implement that in your system. And then internships are very, very important. Now everything is compulsory. Everyone has to take up an internship. You ensure that in whichever area you want to go, say after fourth year, you have decided to go to some sort of manufacturing company. So you should preferably take up an internship in a manufacturing company, which will help you in getting into a job, whether it's a paid or free, because people are expecting that every company should pay them for internship. Not many companies will pay for internship. Even if they're paying you for internship, they'll actually maybe asking to do very menial thing like, you know, do you get the file from there or copy and paste this and send to some 10 people, something like that, you know, opening an email and then copy and direct forward it to somebody else. It really won't matter if it's a paid or a free, but as long as it's possible, you actually learn whatever you're doing and whether it will help you in getting your job. While you're on internship, you observe in the industry how people are working in any office environment, how they are contributing, how the efficiency levels will come up, how the motivations happen. All these things you should silently observe. I forgot to tell you about on these communication skills. When you are on these communication skills, I bring in a small story of my son who was studying civil engineering in RV College, Bangalore. He was in civil engineering second year, and his classmate, he's extremely good in subject, but unfortunately he could not talk anything in English. He cannot explain that entire civil thing in English. But if you ask him to explain in Kannada, he would do fantastic job. So what my son did, even he is also good in civil, both of them, they used to sit in the cafeteria under a tree, and my son would ask his friend to explain the one topic in English. That boy struggled so much to explain in English in the first few days. Then slowly what happened, over 6 months, that boy was able to actually explain reasonably well in English. By the end of third year, he was very fluent in English, and the boy got selected in the campus selection in the first level itself. So that is what I'm telling. If you are confident, you can help another person in your own circles. So don't ever think that, okay, I know English and it's enough for me. You can always help some other person who actually needs that kind of a help. Nobody else other than you can help your own friends. So let's go back to my internship. Your thing is over. Internships are very important. Now you know for sure, you know you have done a good project, you have done a good internship, maybe two internships or three internships. Now you create a resume which is brief and concise. Don't put a project name. Many people make a mistake of writing the project name and then write one full page of the project. Nobody is interested in reading your full project. Only the title and a brief like 4 lines or 5 lines of the project. That's it. And achievements. What are all that achievements? Those things are very, very important in a resume. If somebody wants, they will probe you further. Now, how do you look out for jobs? One is your campus placement. Anyway, your TPOs are doing great work. They will try to get good companies to your campus to select. And you basically have to trust them and see how they can help you in that. The second one is direct recruitments. You can always apply to many companies which are giving you the placement advertisements. Whenever it comes to direct recruitments, your family and friends, they will help a lot. And you can always approach your father, uncles, whoever it is, without feeling shy, and let them find out if they have any contacts in some companies and they can place you, or if they have their own family business, they can place you. Then this referrals work a lot in many companies where the current employees, they suggest somebody else from their account, say to the HR. HR will consider them as on a priority basis. So you can find some seniors working in some particular company. You try to ask them to refer you to the HR. So it will help very well. Third one is social media. You go to LinkedIn. You find out who are all the HR people or CEOs, decision makers in a company. First list down about sort of 10 to 15 companies where you would love to work. Then for those 10 to 15 companies, you identify who are all the HR managers and general managers or even the CEOs or founders, whoever it is. You can just find out and get a connection request to them, get through them, read their profile, read their posts, and you comment on their posts or ask for the clarification. Build a relationship in the social media. That's where I'm telling, if you are in a third year, you have one full year to actually build the relationships on social media. Talk to people, get into their good books, and never ask them for a job straight away. Never ever ask anyone directly for a job. You put it in a subtle way saying that, okay, you get into their good books and then you can say, sir, I want to look for something like this. How do you suggest me? What do you suggest me? Something like that. You have to go in a different way, that indirect approach. Never ever ask anybody directly the day you get connected, say, I'm looking for a job. So they will just ignore you. So what you must do, you should actually do some good projects, do some good internships, improve your communication skills, keep talking to people, keep encouraging people to talk to you, then identify work companies where you want to work, then check out what kind of skills they need, because you may like to work in a company, but why they will pick you up, why they should pick you up. So basically, you should always have a match between you and your industry. Most of the time, college is totally different from the industry. If you are not understanding what is outside your college, and with your degree alone, you want to get a job, it's very difficult for you to get a job without seeing what industry wants. Even the computer science people, whatever they study, it may not be of much use to get a job. Unless they do some sort of courses in Python, and are probably they are doing data analytics, or they do some cyber crime thing. Unless they have some identified companies and where they can fit in, it will be very difficult for them to even get the jobs. The era of training, earlier every company used to actually take the freshers. They used to train them for 6 months to 1 year. After COVID, I don't think any company will be willing to actually take you and groom you for about 1 year, because they will think it's a waste of time and energy. Instead of that, they will go even for the experienced people to come on a lateral entry. So you have to fight those people also in life. So you be prepared, not only your subject, you have to have some sort of practical approach to what companies need and why they need. And be active on social media, and you should have a lot of confidence. Confidence and confidence is the key. Never hesitate to ask anyone, anytime, whatever you are in doubt. If you don't ask, nobody is going to actually help you. Nobody will come to you and say, okay, I think you have a doubt and let me solve. Unless you ask someone, nobody is going to help you. You have to help yourself. I think I will stop this here. Then I would like to take more number of questions and answers so that this will help you in understanding more. Now you can
dear participants, you could type in your questions in the chat box, and Mr. Ramesh can address them. Thank you.
Ask, people ask. If you don't ask, we can't tell you. They don't have questions, surprisingly. How to improve communication skills? Okay, first let me answer to Sahana Suryanarayana. She asked about how to improve the communication skills. That's what I said. Communication are two things. One is written communication, one is verbal communication. Most of the engineering students are very good in, generally good in quantitative analytical skills, and you know how to do things. You can write a program. Everything is fine. Written communication, we never have any problem with the engineering students. The major problem with engineering students is the communication skills and presentation skills. So communication is basically, you should be able to express what you want to express, the other person should understand. It could be in your own language or it could be in English. If it is English, it is the best. If it's not in English, you please try to, if that other person knows your local language, go ahead with the local language. There's nothing wrong about it. Russians talk to Russians in Russian, and French will talk to their people in French. Japanese will talk in Japanese. There is nothing wrong in talking in your own language, as long as the other person is also comfortable with the same language. Suppose if North Indian comes and you can't say, I can explain only in Kannada. It won't work that way. So there again, your common thing is only English. So, and you people have all studied entire 4-year engineering in English. So you should pick up English more, and you should start practicing more. How do you actually use the words? How do you frame the sentences? And how do you express yourself? You don't need to actually talk like a Shashi Tharoor language. Nobody expects you to talk in a high level of language. Use very simple words, what is common words. Only use those things, and then you keep talking. Best thing I told you is, as I told you in the system, in the presentation, where you just record yourself on a video, you will know how you are talking. And you say, share that video with another person and ask him, how did you talk on this particular topic? Within 3 months to 4 months, I bet you will make a tremendous progress on that particular point. Okay.
Yeah, the video.
How to get rid of fear and develop more confidence when presenting a seminar project? I learned some new things from your presentation, sir. It was very helpful. Nishant, the only thing what you can do is, whenever you are giving a presentation, most of the people, they do a presentation and they read every line of it. You should never read every line of it, because people are seeing the presentation, they can also read. Only thing is, you have to keep telling them in a different way, or extension of the topic what you're showing on the screen. On the screen, you should show only 4 lines or 5 lines, that's it. All balance, the explanation should come from your topic. And of course, the major problem for most of the people who are giving first time or second time presentations is a stage fear. If you don't have a stage fear, you will definitely can give a good presentation. If you have a stage fear, you look at one person who is very known to you or very comfortable with, you just talk to that particular person only. No problem. First presentation you give to only one person, and like Arjuna killing the fish with only seeing with only one eye. He sees only the eye, nothing else. Eye of the fish, nothing else he sees. So you see only that particular person out of 100 people, and then you give a lecture to only one person. It doesn't matter. And slowly you will always improve upon. So best thing is the flow, how you want to present the entire thing. You should think like the other person sitting in front of you, how that particular person will think. And you actually go as per that flow, then you will not be able to do any mistake on that particular front. And practice it more than once or twice if you want. You can just have a timer and then record yourself and then see how you are actually talking on video. So to nowadays, your videos have become so powerful. You can always record your own. Instead of selfie photo, you make a selfie video of your presentation, how you are talking, and then play it yourself. It will help you a lot. And next is how to get internship during these COVID times. Yeah, good question. Nobody knows the answer for that. You have to try yourself, talk to your friends, and like that is what I was telling. If you have good contacts in LinkedIn, you can always pull them off and you can do something on that particular front. But for that also, you should know very clearly which company you want to do, what kind of internship. I don't know what branch you are, Nihal. Okay. Then who is asking? There are so many, or somebody can read up. Can you speak about the role of competitive programming for job placement? See, competitive programming is always good to know your strengths basically. Don't expect them to see your code and then select you for a job. If you are very confident, you have been doing all the competitive programming, you know how to, you have gone to hackathons and you may be doing something online, it will actually boost your courage and morale actually. So use that, and once you are very confident in that programming, you can, whenever you go to a job, if they say, okay, this is the problem, you can just give me a code in next 15 minutes. You will be able to actually do it fast. So it always helps you. So you keep practicing, that is where practice makes man perfect. Keep playing. Then, sir, please let me tell us about good resume building. Yeah, resume building, generally, typically people write stories in a resume. No HR has got time to read your 4-page document or 5-page document. Your first page should give me the complete information about yourself. Second page could be a slightly additional information like more about the projects or whatever it is. So in the page one, I don't even need your address and phone numbers, whether you are married, not married, how many brothers you have, how many sisters you have, none of my business. I don't even bother about those things. So actually all your personal details, you can still move them to the second page. First page, you should have only brief information of your educational qualifications. Who are you? What do you want to do in future? What is that excites you? If you have got an achievement, you have participated somewhere, you got some awards, those things you mention, and then you project what is your project you have done and what internships you have done in a brief. In the second page, you talk about whatever you want in a, that also again in a brief, and then your personal details. That will help you a lot in keeping the resume brief. Second one is you preferably don't use high level of jargon. You don't use different fonts and different colors to highlight, because when most of the HR many companies, they have some sort of resume formatting system. So it goes into our application tracking system that is called ATS. Once all resumes are dumped in either a PDF or Word or any format, that ATS will read them and then put them into the database. So you, whatever you're mentioning, it should be readable by the machine. It should understand what is your educational qualifications, extracurricular activities, achievements, date of birth, and all those kind of a thing in a proper format. Don't confuse the resume with a lot of fonts and beautification. Yes, sometimes making a unique resume helps. Suppose one person, what he has done, he was a CAD designer. What he has done, he actually made a pizza box. He made a 3D diagram, and entire thing, he printed a box of a pizza. On that, every part of the pizza box, he has mentioned his resume. And that box he sent to a HR person saying that this is my resume. So the HR got really surprised. No, it is not only giving the idea of CAD, how he has used the CAD and how he has actually converted that into a resume. So that is called creativity. So I am not telling everybody should follow that, but I am telling this kind of a thing come out of the box. So you should think how you can impress the people. suppose you have written a competitive program, something, you know, you can write a small program in a quiz format and send to the CEO of the company or CEO of the company, saying that you break it and you'll understand who I am. So something like that. If you are working on a cyber thing, you know, you send him an encrypted file and say, boss, you break it to see my resume. You challenge him. So something like that. See, those kind of a things is what is a creative resume. But otherwise, if you are putting everything in paper and pencil, you just make it very simple. Don't use complicated designs in the colors and all that. You make it simple, two color format or one color format or whatever. Yeah. Is it compulsory to put out weakness in resume? Actually, no. You never talk about your weakness. I keep telling you to strengthen the strength than covering your weaknesses. You may have a lot of weaknesses and few strengths. So you don't tell everyone that I don't know this, I don't know this. You always tell what you know and what you know very well. So you try to actually bring an interviewer to your strength. How many people have learned about a cow? One student knows only about cow. So anybody ask about, explain the cow, you will say cow has got one nose, one tongue, one, two ears, two horns. So you ask him anything, you will bring back to that topic only. So if you are strong in something, you focus on that, strengthen that, you wait the interviewer to ask a question on that particular thing. For example, I was very good at circuit breakers and switch gear in electrical engineering. So in any interview, I used to say, I did my project in this, I did this. So we passionately talk about the circuit breaker. So they say, okay, let me try you on circuit breaker. So they'll ask a question on circuit breaker. I would know what exactly to answer. So we have to bait the interviewers more and more with the same keywords so that he will ask you certain questions, we explore more. So don't worry about your weaknesses. For every one strength, you will definitely have 10 weaknesses. So you don't need to put any of those weaknesses. Somebody asked, which industry do you think will be able to provide more job opportunities after pandemic? There are four industries which are evergreen in any kind of recession or pandemic. One is entertainment. Whether you like it or not, your TV is giving you all kinds of news, all kinds of entertainment. Your YouTube is full. Every housewife is actually using YouTube to give a recipe every day today. And everyone is watching movies. Everything is going on. Netflix, Amazon Prime, everything is going on very well. So entertainment is one area, is always evergreen. Second one is health. Whether you like or not, you have to spend on healthcare. Healthcare is going to be evergreen. Third one is your education system. Whether you like or not, education has to be given to your kids. That is why even for first standard to 12th standard, now e-learning systems have started. EdTech is booming today. Everybody in EdTech is making money. Fourth one is the e-commerce. E-commerce is a new item because earlier recessions only three were there. Now this pandemic has brought in power of e-commerce. Today we are sitting at home, you are getting everything at home. So, and even the deliveries have improved so much. You order a medicine on pharmacy today, by tomorrow morning it is delivered. Earlier they used to take about 2 days or whatever it is. They used to take their own sweet time. Now because there is no revenue, not much of revenue, and whatever orders they get, they are trying to close it at the earliest so that they can make money out of it. So these four are evergreen, even pandemic or no pandemic or recession or no recession. So you people can always find out, if you are a computer science guy, you have wide opportunity to enter all the four segments. And any other four people, they will find it a bit difficult, but they can always go into the logistics of e-commerce, or some people like biotechnology guys can go into pharma and healthcare. So they have a huge opportunity there in those areas. So these four areas are going to be always green. Okay, what else? What are the innovative technologies on which projects can be made? It depends on your own area. I don't know. Who asked this from Akshi? So it depends on your areas. Actually, if you are in computer science, data analytics, your artificial intelligence, machine learning makes a lot of sense. Cyber crime makes a lot of sense. so many things are there. You can say voice-based technologies or more hand recognition-based technologies or any biometric verifications. All these things come into computer science. If you talk about civil, the civil people may have that prefabs, how they build it, and that kind of thing. Even my son, who was in a civil, so I keep talking about civil because I keep hearing the technologies, what they use. And recently, he said, in one of those buildings where it's a multi-storied apartment where they're supposed to build, they constructed the whole thing in the ground floor, then raised that entire floor to the first floor, and they started constructing the ground floor again. So actually, slowly, as they go up, every time they're raising one floor, just above one more floor. So they don't need to actually make the scaffolding go up to the top floor and start working on it. So that once they completely fill the interiors, everything is done, they lift the entire apartment complex to one floor. So that was an amazing technology which I never heard, and I wanted to go and see also, but unfortunately I didn't see. So you have to be in touch with your own people. You have to read more about the technology and see how you can do that. And can you suggest two websites for opportunities? Boss, you just go to Google, you get plenty, plenty. And even on LinkedIn itself, they have got LinkedIn jobs, you can get plenty. But more than that, don't get bugged up with the job like that. You first find out which are the companies where you want to work. Go as per that. So don't, that's what, when you say, give me websites for job opportunities, it actually narrows down, because in that part, you go to any particular website and say jobs or freshers, you start applying without even reading the company name, what is the each one. So I recommend you first to find out which are all the companies you want to work first. Based on that, you start working on that, checking each company and where you will fit in. Then you contact the HR, then you apply for those companies through the websites and all that. Or many times you can directly go to their own company website and then apply directly there. So that actually helps a lot. And you will also know what that company does and what you can expect out of it and all that. If nothing is working out, yes, okay, you can go to general portals and keep applying. That is there, plenty. Naukris are there, jobstreet.com, freshupsworld.com. There are so many websites. Or you can ping me later, I can give you a list of 100 websites if you want. Then, how much importance should be given to acquiring certified courses on our resume? See, there are two parts to this concept of certified courses. See, what is it, why you are learning a course, whether it is for your knowledge or for the certificate? This is very important. So if you have a certificate, we presume that you know a lot of things on that particular course. So when you actually ask interview on that particular subject, if you are not able to answer, your certificate has absolutely no value. And the second one, if you know more and if you don't have a certificate also, it doesn't really matter for us, and we can always check whether you know something, and if that is relevant to my company, I can always check more about whether you know that or not. So don't focus on the certificate part of it. Focus on the course part of it. Certificate may help somebody to actually have a look at you. That helps you. That's it. What else? Okay, how much that's what is done. There are some more on the top. How many government competitive exams are there for electronics? There are plenty. BL has, HAL has got, ECIL. There are so many public sectors, they take everyone. Even BHL has got people from electronics. So there are a lot of public sector companies available who take electronics people, but you have to go through the GATE exam. Most of the public sector are hiring through GATE exam. You clear the GATE and that marks automatically go to the public sectors, including BHEL and some other companies. Otherwise also they have a management training program. You can always apply for that. Sir, startup or service based company, which to choose? I am not clear about the question. Does GATE exam help to get admission abroad? I am not sure that you have to check with the GATE brochure. How many other colleges accept that abroad? Somebody said, can you tell me which helps you in websites in improving better communication skills? I think I will. You have my email ID. You can always ping me. I can connect them directly. There are a lot actually. Somebody asked an interesting question. He says, how can I find out passion of mine? This is a very interesting question. You must be thinking about one particular topic all the time. And if anything, one sec, I just have to put the power onto my laptop. Sorry. Yeah. So how do you know what passion you have? Other than you, nobody will be able to tell you. How, what kind of passion? You will be always be, actually, if you have a passion, you will be spending a lot of time thinking about it, dreaming about it, and you'll be talking about it. You ask your friend, every time we meet, what I'm talking about. That friend will tell you what is your passion if you don't know your own passion. Sir, if the college does not offer placements, how do you get into a good job? This is not a big issue today because everybody knows most of the companies come only to tier one cities, and tier two cities, tier three cities are generally affected. You can always find, see, that's why I keep telling you should know where exactly you want to go. First list 15 to 20 companies where you want to definitely work. And you start working backwards. Why they should hire you, what kind of role you can do there, how it helps. So don't worry about campus placements. And one thing is you have to motivate your own college to have a training and placement officer. Then he will be able to coordinate and all that kind of a thing. Our second one is your college, if they are not even taking this thing, maybe somebody should start industry camp, they should come and invite them for giving a lecture in your own department. Then slowly you can build a relationship with those industries. Then your job prospects go very high. What are the prerequisites to get internship on LinkedIn? On LinkedIn, it will be on LinkedIn means not from the company LinkedIn. Yes, if you have a relationship with someone on LinkedIn, you can request some people. I think the chances are there, but I can't say everybody will give you an internship whomever you talk on LinkedIn because they should be from your own same city or similar lines of business. They should have some sort of opening. And if you are expecting paid internship, definitely chances are low. If you want only for experience sake, and if you really can contact something, probably they will get something. Plus, there are some companies who are actually offer internships. Maybe if you come across that kind of a person on LinkedIn, they'll be able to help you in getting a LinkedIn, internship through LinkedIn. On what topic should we make projects? This is totally depends on your area, your interest. I have seen people making race cars year after year in the same college. This one team will take the car to Netherlands. Next year, the same car is taken to some other country. I never understand why you should be doing the same project again and again, and you are never going to make a Formula F1 or F3. Yes, it helps you in learning a lot about dynamics of the car, suspension of the car, how the acceleration, deceleration happens. It's an excellent project, but is it sufficient for you? And are you going into automobile sector? If you are going into automobile specialization or to something, yes, that particular project will help you a lot. If you are not doing that and you are going into some other area, your project, your race car project is of not much use. I mean, if it's not related to your job, then it doesn't really help. Okay, you can tell how you solve the issue and probably they will like it and say, okay, if you can solve the problem on a race car, you can be able to solve my regular conveyor belt problem. If you are confident, it's fine. But If you have done very thing similar, suppose you have done something on a race car, and then you apply for say Mahindra, and Mahindra is developing say a XUV, a better model, or they are making into a race car, you know, then your expertise definitely helps them, and then it will help you a lot. So depending on you have, that is why I told you in the beginning itself, in the final year, before final year, you should identify which kind of industry you want to go, how you want to actually approach them, and how do you get employed there. So you have to have a bigger vision than having just applying to any company and getting a job. It won't work. You have to plan from the third year onwards, which company you want to work, where you want to work, how you want to work, what is your liking, whether you like production area, you want to designing. Even in automobile, probably if you are working on a race car project, which part of it you are interested, whether you are interested in doing the welding part of it, are you interested in designing the suspension, which suspension takes care of what, and how the balance is happening, and are you doing only the sort of test run? Maybe you are interested only in doing the test drive part of it. So you can become only a race driver, not the designer or somebody else. So in every design, you have to see where actually you belong to, and where, which kind of a job you can actually be fitting in. What else? Is that scoring marks is more important to get job in a good company? No. Slowly, marks is becoming only a criteria of first level screening. It doesn't mean that if you are less than 60%, you are a waste. Nowadays, people actually don't bother about your marks and all that kind of a thing. Marks definitely give people one idea that how good you are in your subject. We presume that you are good because you got a good mark, so we don't actually force much on that. So what we do is, even if you get 90% in your core engineering, I would still love to see what kind of practical problems you could solve. That is where actually you will be probed, not on the your subject. Suppose you got 100% in some subject, I don't care. You may be good in that subject, but that I am not using that particular subject at all in my company. So I don't even bother. Suppose if I am using the same subject and I need some sort of good people, then I will probe in that particular subject and see how much you know theory and what kind of practicals you have done in an internship. So your internships are very, very critical. Your project work is very critical. So please do take your project works very, very seriously and internships very seriously. Most of the project work, they come to any company, they will work for about 15 days, 20 days. They just vanish for the next 90 days or 120 days. Then they will come back with a small letter saying that, sir, project work is completed. Can you please sign? I would not have seen even the output of the project, but I would have just signed and given because I know that students are not very serious in the project. Please don't do that. Learn yourself very well. What you are doing, you should know what exactly you are doing and why you are doing, and you should be able to answer any question on that. Yes, good marks will give you a lot of confidence in your own thing. Yes, it will help you in gaining your confidence. You understood the concepts very well. All that is fine. But at the same time, if you are not become a topper, you don't really worry about it. If you are looking for a job, once they have a screening exam, you are as good as anybody else. Suppose if you go for a GATE exam, whether you are a topper in your college or not a topper in your college, your GATE marks only count. So don't worry, really worry about those things. You actually focus on your both the skills, technical skills and the practical skills. The practical skills include your project work and your internships and how much you can communicate. So I always keep telling, at the end of the day, you may have an excellent marks in your college, but if you can't communicate well, the whole thing goes down the drain. So you should know how to communicate well, how do you project yourself well, how do you position yourself well. So what else? Some person says, what is the best startup idea? You should never ask anyone for a startup idea, because if I have an idea, I would have started my own startup. Why should I give you my idea? So never think that way. You should look around and see how you can see somebody's pain point. I tell you one story about PS University, PS College. One startup company came, and then he wanted to see, the PS has given them an office space where he can work from there. So this gentleman, he started sitting there, one man only. Then he looked around and then found that every engineering topper who passes, who is in the final year, he would never share his notes with anyone else. He has a secret notes. He will master it. He will write. He will get good scores and he will go out of the college. So what this man has done, he took out his notes, handwritten notes, put it into a CD and sold it to the next batch juniors. Everybody bought because it was last year topper's notes, handwritten notes. And it, all the CDs just were bought like anything. So next year what he has done, he converted the this year batch ka students, he took out again their notes. He compiled them together and he converted that into a format computer based system, you know, Word and all that kind of a thing, or PDF, something like that. Again burnt into the CD and again sold. It was a massive hit. So now he realized the importance of the toppers and their notes, how these people prepare themselves and how beautifully they are actually making a small notes which is memorable. So next year, third year, he actually created the e-learning system, taking inputs from all the toppers' inputs and all that. Then he created a new e-learning platform that is called EduWrite. I don't know how many people you know it, but then it was sold to Pearson View and then they sold it to someone else. I think Byju's bought it, I think. So any idea, you it may be just around you, you will not know. You should see if somebody is suffering from something or there's a chance, you just do it. Suppose in India, now what happened, the COVID situation came. Now suddenly every garment manufacturer is making masks, including Ramraj Dhotis, he is making masks. Including Wildcraft, who was into bags, they are making masks. So this is the opportunity. So they saw the opportunity of masks. Nobody is actually looking for N95 masks, which are supposed to be used in the COVID situation. Now, because you don't have N95, which is very expensive thing, which is about 500 rupees or 300 rupees, people are using the simple masks, which are made out of cloth. So this is called entrepreneurship. So you should be able to see where there is an opportunity. If somebody is crying, it means there is an opportunity for you. If somebody is celebrating, there is an opportunity for you. If anything happens, you will look for an opportunity there. COVID-19 is a great opportunity for edtech companies. They started e-learning platforms, and if you tie up with 10 schools, they made their money. So 10 schools and each school having 1,000 students, he has got 10,000 students, and per student even he charges 1,000 rupees, he made his money. So this is how the entrepreneurship works. So you don't ask anyone about what kind of idea you should get. You actually should keep looking around and you will get an idea. Then. Sir, can you provide more information about scholarships exams held for higher studies? I don't know much about that. Actually, if you ping me separately, I can always do some research and give you that data. You can take me on offline. I think you can get my email ID somewhere else. I think I can show that again, once again, or whatever it is, or the organizers can share it with you. Anything? Is really marks are important or knowledge and skills? Marks are important to clear the first hurdle. That's it. After that, your knowledge and skills are more important. The marks may take you up to the interview table, and after the interview, at the interview, your knowledge and skills count. So never underestimate knowledge and skills. If you have only high marks, it doesn't help you. You should be able to explain well and what you have learned, and you have to prove that your marks are reflecting your knowledge and skills. If you're not able to convince them that what you know because of your high marks equivalent to knowledge and skills, it is not going to help you anything. But sometimes some companies, they may not even look at marks, like Google. Now they said even school dropout they can consider if they are good in their knowledge and skills. So slowly, the importance and dependence on marks is going to go a bit low, but you should always practice more on your knowledge and skills. That is very, very important. Anything? We have time or? At present, which are the booming technologies in which more job opportunities will come up? See, This is a very tricky issue. Most of the companies, they actually leveraged artificial intelligence and machine learning to automate their processes. With that, what happened? A lot of jobs are cut. So you can't say the technology is related to the job. You should not treat it as a threat or an advantage. So basically, artificial intelligence can do a lot of stuff. If you are looking for a routine job, sorry, you will very soon be obsolete and some artificial intelligence machine is going to replace you. If you are an engineer, you stick to something where you can give more value addition to your job. What is engineering teaching you in 4 years? You take any subject, it really doesn't matter. Engineer by definition is the one who solves the problem. You are doing a chemical engineering, actually you are solving an issue in chemical engineering. If you are a mechanical engineer, you are solving a problem related to machines. If you are an electrical engineer, you are solving a problem of electricity or electrical associated issues. So basically any engineer is actually doing a job of only problem solver. So that is where you are very strong in qualitative, quantitative, analytical skills. You know how to solve the problem. And if you can explain someone how you solve the problem with your communication skills, you become a perfect employee. So you practice your quantitative skills, analytical skills, even if you apply for jobs, most of the jobs, they will actually do an aptitude test where they ask you quantitative questions, qualitative questions. They'll say, if a frog in the well jumps 3 feet up and then slides down to 1 foot and the wall is that well is about 10 feet, how many days it will reach? What are they trying to get you? They're actually thinking whether you are really able to think and calculate and then give you. It's not that, okay, why I have to bring the frog out of the well. No, they're basically checking how your mind works. That kind of a questions will help you a lot. So don't worry about which technology gives you more jobs and all that. Definitely new technologies are going to give you a lot of jobs. Today, if you see about cryptocurrency is going to give a lot of things. It depends on you actually. Cyber crimes, how do you stop cyber crimes? It seems like in the last 40 days, China has hacked about 40,000 websites of India. Can you stop it? We don't know. So where are the big cyber experts? Nobody knows. But the sites are getting hacked left and right. Even Indian Roadways entire website was hacked for 24 hours. They couldn't repair it. After 24 hours, it came back. That's a different issue. So there may be a lot of things. You have to keep studying different things in your own area. Identify where you will fit in and then you follow that. That will help you a lot. So between a government and private organization, which is better for a fresher in computer science student? Good question. I worked in public sector for about 18 years and then private sector about 20 years. Both actually are good in their own way. In a government organization, you have a complete job security. You can do a lot of mistakes. Your bosses will take care of all those other things. And you can, if you don't want to work, nothing will happen. Nobody cares. Out of 100 people, only 15 to 20 people in a public sector work very hard. About 60%, they will say average, you come and go. And the 20% people, they don't even work, but they still manage to get the salaries. But the top 15% are the people who actually work very hard in any public sector company or government agency. And in a private agent, in private, basically, again, similar things happen. If the company has got large number of people, if the company has got 1 lakh people, you don't expect all 1 lakh people are doing a lot of work. Out of that, maybe about 30 to 40% of people are on the bench because they don't have a project. So don't think that by going to a private company, you get a lot of exposure, or in the public sector, you don't get an exposure. Even in public sector, if you want to do a lot of things, you can definitely do a lot of things. Like we have, when I joined BHEL, there was no computerization. Very few programs were there. But then we started working on how to build the systems. In 1980s, there were no systems at all. So we slowly built the systems, and then by 1984, 85, 86, we started building material requirement planning. Then we slowly upgraded to manufacturing resource planning. That is what we call MRP2, which is equivalent to ERP outside. We didn't even know that there is something called ERP outside. But what we have built is a computer-based system from zero to final inventory control. Everything is under computers. So 89, we have completed the ERP in BHEL without even knowing what is happening outside. So opportunities are there in both the areas. If you want to take initiative, you can do a lot of initiatives in public sector. They have got a lot of money also to spare. Private sector, sometimes what happens if a product you are going to develop, you have an interest and the company is not able to make money, they may not show interest in your particular product. So what happens is you get frustrated. If it is useful for the company, yes, definitely they will allow you to do some experiment and then they will convert that into your product. If they don't see a value in that, and then if they think they will not be able to sell it, so they will think why you have to spend so much of money on doing research on that particular product for you. So that kind of a problem will always be there. So you have to be very clear in what exactly you want to do, where you want to do.
Mr. Ramesh Kumar?
Yeah, lot of things going on.
Thank you so much for your patience, sir. You have answered so many questions. We thank you. A big thank you from the ICER team for your valuable presentation and for answering all the questions patiently. I'm sure all the participants will treasure your teachings for a lifetime. And this will also broaden their vision for the future. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you all participants for joining in today.
I have just given my email ID where they can be in touch or you can share it with them whenever.
Sure. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you guys. Thanks a lot for patiently listening to me. Thank you all.